All right, it's good to have you with us for our Bible class this evening. Let me give you a few announcements first of all. Hope you'll remember and be here Sunday. Travis Anderson and his family will be with us. He'll be preaching, teaching the Bible class Sunday morning and preaching Sunday morning, and we hope you'll be here for that. I got just a few announcements about sick folks. Bruce Goodnow is going to have a pacemaker installed, we think, Friday. So keep Bruce in your prayers. Kim Shaleen will be having surgery next Wednesday to remove a tumor and a couple of lymph nodes. And so please keep her in your prayers. Eric Naltz, a co-worker of Tim's, is also in need of our prayers. And so we want to keep him in our prayers as well. So keep those folks in mind and we'll pray for them in just a few moments. We're in Revelation chapter 2, and this evening we're going to be looking at the church in Ephesus. It's interesting because I'm going to spend more time here than I do any of the other seven churches, simply because I've been there, seen it, and so I'm going to spend a lot of time there. Also, we know more about the church in Ephesus than we do the others of the seven churches, simply because we know about Paul going there on his second missionary tour and spending 3 years there on his third missionary tour. So we know a lot more. We also have a letter written to the Ephesians. We also know that John is going to spend his life there. And so really, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John are probably written from there. And Revelation probably at least is finished. He may be writing part of it on the island of Patmos, but it's probably finished in Ephesus. So we know a lot about Ephesus, and so I'm going to camp out there a lot more than I will with the other churches. Our text, chapters 2 and 3, will give us the text of seven short letters to the seven churches in the Roman province in Asia Minor. We learned about all of those in chapter 1, verse 11, but they're not the only churches in the province. We've already noted Troas is there. The Apostle Paul will leave from Troas when he'll get the Macedonian call, come over to Macedonia and help us. That's at Troas. He'll be back there at the end of his third missionary tour, and he will there be preaching till midnight, and Eutychus falls out of the window, and so we know a little bit about Troas. Colossae, we have a letter written to the church in Colossae, the Colossians. Again, Paul has never been there, but he writes to that church, and so it's important. Hierapolis is mentioned in Colossians 4:13, and then there are two more churches that are in the province that Ignatius in his writings will mention, Magnesia and Tralles. And so we have lots of churches in Asia, in that part of Asia. Why are these seven churches singled out? Why does he do these seven churches and not the others that we've just mentioned? Well, they're on a great road that kind of circles through the province, the interior of the province. And so it's sort of as if they're all in that kind of road. And I have a suspicion that it may well be because of his connection to Ephesus that those are so important to him. But again, Jesus is going to dictate the letter. They may have been churches where John had done some missionary work. That may be another reason. Only these seven bore the title Metropolis. All these seven are big cities. And so they're the only ones that will have that title, a metropolis. And so, again, a kind of postal district, if that makes any sense to us today. They're really important cities. And so for that reason, I think he's going to do it. The number seven is important. He chooses seven of them. The number seven I mentioned on Sunday appears 54 times in the book, lots of times. It indicates probably it's not just written to the seven churches, but to the church as a whole, because that's the number, a fullness number. It's a full number, and so it really is important, and so that becomes important. Why these? For John, according to the Muratorian Canon, written about AD 70, by the way, a canon is a list of which books belong in the Bible. And there's this canon that lists the books that are supposed to be in the New Testament. And it gives reasons for those. And here's what the Muratorian Canon says. For John also, though he wrote to in Revelation to seven churches, nevertheless speaks to them all. He's writing to seven individual churches, but he really expects all of them to get something from the seven letters. Got it? And so all of us ought to get something from these seven letters to the seven churches as well. It's evident that the letters did not circulate separately. It isn't, you know, you have a letter to 1 Corinthians to the church in Corinth, or Ephesians, the church in Ephesus, or Colossians, the church in... But these didn't separate, go separately. It's not like he sends this letter and this letter and this letter. They circulate together. And so they're really important to that as a whole. The message of the whole book is addressed in them and through them to the whole church. And so really, ultimately, the message comes to us as well. There's some common features in these letters. First of all, they are all dictated by the Lord Himself. Jesus dictates all of these letters, and John writes them down or has his secretary to write them down. There's a big debate about whether he writes them by hand himself or has a secretary to do that. They are addressed to the angel of the specific church. Each church has its own angel. And the letters are addressed to the angel, interestingly enough. Except for Laodicea, the titles by which the Lord describes himself are all drawn from the vision that we got back in chapter 1, where he will call himself these things, and we'll see them in all of them except the letter to the church in Laodicea. Common structure to the letters, there's a salutation, normal kind of greeting like you'd expect. There is Christ's description of himself. I am, and he'll talk about who he is. And then there is praise for good qualities and good works. Here are good things you folks are doing. And even the churches that get rebuked, and they all get a bit of a rebuke except a couple, two only positive things are said about, but they all get praise for something good they're doing. We'll see in the church in Ephesus, although he's going to give them an accusation at the end, he's going to begin by giving them some good qualities. Here are good things about you. And then he'll blame them for their failings. Here's what you're not doing, and here's where you've missed it. And then he will appeal to them and warn them, if you don't, I'm going to come and take away your lamp. We'll hear at the end of ours tonight. And so that becomes important. And then there's an exhortation. He who has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Now, he who has ears to hear, that sounds familiar to us because Jesus will frequently say that after a parable. And so that's not unusual. Here it's to the churches, so hear what the Spirit says, because the Spirit is speaking through what Jesus says to the churches. And then there's a bit of a promise. Interestingly enough, the last four are going to reverse 6 and 7. It'll be a promise and then an exhortation. The others will go exhortation, then promise. But basically the same structure. In the letters to Smyrna and Philadelphia, there are no words of condemnation. Isn't that nice? Wouldn't it be nice to be one of those churches that he doesn't have anything bad to say about? He only commends them for what they're doing. The letter to the church at Laodicea, there is no commendation. He doesn't say anything positive about that church. And so he only has negative things to say about it. Well, we'll see that as we work our way through these letters. The letter to Ephesus is in chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. Our text begins, "To the angel of the church in Ephesus, write." And so he's going to write down the message. And again, Jesus is dictating it, and our man John is to write it down. Ephesus is the most important city in the province of Asia. It is a big city and was really, really important. It's one of my favorite places to go because it got destroyed by an earthquake and it never got rebuilt. And so they can dig any place they want to dig. And they can find anything that's there. And so it becomes really an important location. It's located on the mouth of the Caistor River, and it's an important commercial center. Interestingly enough, it's on a river, and the river, they're going to dig a canal from the river and put a harbor there, and the harbor is right at the city. And the boats will come into their harbor and spend the winter there or whatever. If the weather's bad, they'll stay there, and they'll bring commodities in there. Then they'll come back out at the river and down to the ocean and sail off to wherever they have to go. Okay? So it's important in that regard. Here's a nice map, and you'll notice the Caistor River is on there. You can see it, I think. Where is it? There it is, Caistor River, right there, the Caistor River. And there's Ephesus. And notice it's back from the ocean. It's not really right on the ocean. You may remember that when Paul is getting ready to go to Jerusalem, where he'll ultimately be arrested and go to Rome, you'll remember that he will call for the elders from the church in Ephesus to meet him at Miletus. And Miletus is down here, and you'll notice it's right on the ocean. The other harbor is silting up by New Testament times, by Paul's day. And so it's not as good a harbor. Plus, I think he thinks saying goodbye to those folks is going to be too hard. And it's because he spent so much time there with them. A canal is dug from the river. The harbor was never very good. It was never one of your first-class harbors. Because, again, it's a harbor that is in a canal, off of a canal. And then it's off a river. And then you have to sail from there. But it was never a really grand one. And because of all the rain and the deforestation that was going around, we've been through that before, right? All the silt comes down the river, and it fills in their harbor. In Paul's day, it was already silting up. Today, the ruins of Ephesus are 5 miles across a marshy lowland from the Aegean Sea. So it's 5 miles inland. Now, this is a nice picture. I found it today. I had never seen this one before, but it really is kind of nice because it shows you here's the river, and there's the canal they dig, and there's their harbor. And there's the theater. I'll show you the theater in a few moments. And I took pictures looking back to look at the harbor, and I can see the harbor, but it's a long way. The canal's all filled in. There is no canal today. It's all silted up. This is my picture that I took, and you can see, again, I'm standing in the theater, and I'm looking out, and this is where the harbor once was, right there, way out there, but the ocean is clear back there, 5 miles away. It's interestingly enough, it's kind of marshy area, and that's what is part of all that remains of the little canal that was there originally. Pergamum was the capital, but Ephesus was the seaport via the river, and it was a commercial center. And here's a nice map. This map has lots of things on it of importance, but you'll notice here is Ephesus, just inland a little, and there is Miletus where Paul came. There's Smyrna, Sardis, Philadelphia, Pergamum, there's the capital city, Hierapolis, etc. Okay. Right, and here's another one, and this one I put a little block box there to point, oops, if I would hit the right button, it would help. If you look right here, that arrow is pointing to where Ephesus is today. And today, the harbor that is there, there is a harbor on the Aegean 5 miles away, but there's a harbor there that's called Kushadasi. Kushadasi is the city that's there today. And if you go today and you're on a ship like I was, I sailed into Kushadasi, and then we had to take a bus to get to see Ephesus and get to spend some time there. And really, we got to spend most of a day there. This is the main road that leads to the city from the harbor, and you can see a couple of pictures of it. The Temple of Artemis is one of the major structures there. It's considered one of the 7 wonders of the ancient world. Ephesus was the Temple of Artemis, or Diana. Diana, by the way, is the Latin name. Artemis is the Greek name. It's dedicated to the goddess of fertility and the hunt. And so she's the goddess of all of those things. It is 4 times larger than the Parthenon. Now, I don't know whether you've got a feel for how big the Parthenon, but it's big. And if you've ever seen the one in Nashville, it's about a tenth of the size of the other one, so it's really big. But it's really big, 4 times larger. Interestingly enough, it had originally 120 different columns. Each of the columns were 60 feet high, and each one was the gift of a king. A king will give them a pillar. And so the kings from all over the world are giving them pillars to be a part of their temple. And so that becomes important. Only the foundation and one column remains of the temple today. The temple originally was 425 feet by 220 feet and over 60 feet tall. So you get a feel for how big it is. 425 feet. That's a football field and a quarter. Over two football fields the other direction. Ephesus, again, was the center for the worship of Diana and Artemis. And here, again, is the one pillar that is standing. That's all that remains there. And here's the picture that I took. I really like my picture. The other one is one I took as well, but this one is my favorite because you see the bird on top of it. The bird has built a nest up there, and the bird is up on top there with his nest. This is what an artist, somebody has built this model. This is a model that's supposed to look like it would have looked, to give you a feel for what it would have looked like. The Temple of Artemis was rebuilt after a fire in 365 BC, and it continued to be one of the seven wonders of the world until 262 AD when it was destroyed. And all that we have left of it is one pillar today. The image of Artemis was believed to have fallen from heaven. You may remember, for those of you who studied Acts with me, they were saying, why, we have this image of her, and it wasn't made by man, it came from heaven. We think it was probably a meteor or something that came down and landed and looked something like the goddess, but they contended that it came from heaven. The temple was deemed to be the keeper of the great Artemis, and that was one of the proud titles for the city. Ephesus is the keeper of the great Artemis. The principal business was making shrines and statues to the sacred Artemis. And you may remember that the Apostle Paul gets into trouble because he's preaching that there's only one true God, and he was getting lots of converts. And so the folks who were making those idols, the silversmiths, were saying, we're going to lose our jobs. Because by their time, with the harbor silting up, their primary business was tourism. Everybody wants to come and see this one of those seven wonders of the world. And so that becomes important. The temple was not only a place of worship, but it was a kind of ancient bank as well. Folks would come there and exchange money and put money in there for safekeeping. And so it becomes really important. The temple, I already did that. It was also a sanctuary for criminals. Supposedly, no one might be arrested if they shot a bow from the walls of the temple and it hit somebody. You can't be arrested for that, because that's coming from the gods. And so it was a safe place for criminals. Worship was a mixture of Greek and Oriental practices, including sacred prostitution. And so the prostitutes were there. And I'm going to show you something that I think is pretty slick in a moment. It was a center for worship of the emperors and officials, Asiarchs of the imperial temples. And you can see that in Acts chapter 19, verse 31. There's going to be a temple built to every emperor. And I'll show you a couple of those in a moment. This is an advertisement. It's an advertisement for prostitution, for the brothel. You see, you walk that way, see the footprint, walk that way, and do you see the prostitute over there? You can't see her very well, but that's a picture of a prostitute there with her headdress on, etc. And there's a little box down below that originally apparently said something like, come here for business or for a visit or whatever. But at least that's supposed to be an advertisement for the brothel. And it was kind of neat to walk past it and say, ah. But unfortunately, it sits out in the open, so it's wearing down with lots of people walking across it, etc. The Library of Celsus is an important site there. It was originally built in 115 to 125 AD. So this wouldn't have been around in John's day. It's going to be just after John's day. John 95-ish. John probably dies by 100, but 95-ish. And it's built then. It has a wonderful facade that's been restored. And it's in the ruins today. The interior was 70 by 80 feet. And it held 15,000 scrolls. It was deemed to be one of the best libraries in the whole world. God, do you know where the best one was? Alexandria, Egypt, exactly. Alexandria, Egypt was the best one. But this one's interesting. The library was dedicated to Celsus, the proconsul of Asia, and his sarcophagus is in the recess in a section underneath in the library. There is a picture of what the library looked like. Interestingly enough, we have good friends who were stationed for a while in Turkey, and their son graduated from high school while he was in Turkey, and they had the graduation ceremony right there in front of that library. They thought that was a good place to have it. And their daughter was disturbed because they moved back to the States and she didn't get to have her graduation there. She wanted to have hers there. But I thought that was interesting that it was, you know, it was such an important site for everybody, still is. The commercial agora or marketplace is known as the square agora because it is 360 feet square. It is indeed a square. It was surrounded by on all sides by arched shops that were 40 feet deep. It was located next to the harbor as the main commercial center. And again, that's the marketplace, as you can sort of see it, walk down it. And you'll notice several of the pillars, parts of the pillars are standing. It would have originally been covered on both sides. The theater there is really important. It originally held 25,000 people. It was built during the Hellenistic period and was renovated several times by Roman emperors. And so they'll all go through it and do it. You'll remember that they really want to try Paul there, and Paul wants to go there and speak to everybody, but the Christians there say, no, you don't understand how much trouble you're going to get into if you do that. And so they will send him on, and he won't do that. It's designated for theatrical performances, and later alterations will make it used for gladiator games. So guess what? Christians are going to die there. And so that will be important. Here's what it looks like today, and there are some pictures that I took while there. But you can see how big it is. It's kind of amazing because we had somebody go to the top of it, and somebody would drop a coin and say, could you hear it? And you could hear it all the way to the top. Because the acoustics are so good, it's amazing. And there's yet another picture. This is the church that's dedicated to the Apostle John. And so you can see the doors there, but that one's dedicated to John. By the way, there is another church that is dedicated to Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well, with remains today, which I think is interesting. Below is the supposed burial place of John in the church. And Mary is supposed to have died and been buried there as well. And this is Mary's house, if you believe that. It doesn't look like it was built during Mary's day. It looks like it's a little more recent than that. But that's supposedly the case. And there's a fence out front where everybody who, if you're a good Roman Catholic, you go there and you bring your prayers because you think if you can get your prayer to Mary, Mary will tell Jesus, Jesus will tell God, and you'll get what you want. Because you pray through Mary, and so that's going to be important for them. There are a couple of temples, temple to Hadrian, the one at the top on the left, the one at the bottom on the right is one to Domitian, and Domitian is the guy who will be the emperor when our man John gets exiled to Patmos. Okay, and he's one who really, really persecutes Christians, more so than anybody else. He's making it nationwide persecution of Christians. And it becomes a big deal. Ephesus was a center for Christianity as well. Paul established the church there on his second missionary journey in Acts 18. His third missionary journey, he'll stay there 3 years, longer than in any other city. And that becomes important. The church grew so that it had a negative effect on paganism. Those who practice magic are going to destroy all of their books. You'll remember all of that. We saw that when we were working our way through Acts. And it has open hostility to Christianity because of that. While Paul was there, Christianity spread throughout the whole Roman province. And so if that's the case, the whole Roman province is going to get the cities, that these seven cities are going to be some of the places where the church will have spread to. To this church, Paul may have addressed a letter, our Ephesians. It's one of the prison epistles. And again, I told you earlier, that's really a misnomer because he's not in prison. He's under house arrest. And he's in a rented apartment or rented house while he's there. Paul sent Timothy there with special responsibilities. He's supposed to help the church that are dealing with some difficulties, and he's supposed to help the church, stay there and work with the church, preach for the church, and he does that. About the time of the fall of Jerusalem, tradition claims that John left Judea and went to Ephesus, and he spent the last years of his life there. So tradition has it that when Jerusalem is destroyed, you'll remember Jesus told them, now when you see this happening, know it's going to destroy and get out of the city, and they all did. The Christians all left. Supposedly that's when John went to Ephesus, and he'll spend the last 30 years or so of his life in Ephesus, and that becomes important. So here we go. Here's our text. Chapter 2, verse 1. To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand, the one who walks among the seven lampstands, says this. And so that's how it begins, verse 1. The salutation, Jesus describes himself as holding the seven stars in his right hand and walking in the midst of the golden lampstands. The lampstands, you may remember, we saw in chapter 1, the lampstands are the churches. So Jesus is holding the spiritual life in his grasp. He's holding on to them in his right hand, and he is walking right in the middle of them. He's close to all of his churches. So he cares about his churches. I know your deeds and your toil and your perseverance, that you cannot tolerate evil men. You put to the test those who call themselves apostles. They are not. You found them to be false and have perseverance and have endured for my name's sake and have not grown weary. Notice he begins with a word of praise. He's praising them. The first letter reminds them that he knows his churches. He knows what's going on. His knowledge is going to be borne out in all of the letters. In all seven letters, he's going to say, I know you and I know what you're seeing, what you're facing. I know the persecution you're facing. And he'll make a big deal of that with all of the churches. He praises them for their toil. It's an interesting word. It's work to exhaustion. For their toil, their patient endurance, hanging in there to the end, patiently. And they're doing it for his name's sake. That's another way of saying they're doing it for the church, his name's sake. After all, we're named after him. And so they're doing it for him and for his church. The endurance is born under difficult situations, and they're doing this with persecution, and they don't grow weary. Even though it's toiling to exhaustion and enduring hardship, they don't grow weary. And that becomes clear in verse 3. They are praised because they tested the apostles, or those who claim to be apostles. And the word apostle is being used in the generic sense. These are supposed missionaries. And by the way, when you see the word apostle used, not of one of the 12, and Paul added later, it's used in a generic way to mean those who are missionaries. It means literally those sent out. So any missionary could be called an apostle. And here, it may well be that these are false apostles, false missionaries, because they're going to test them. They put them to the test. And they found out that their teaching is false. And I think that's important. Paul in Acts 20 and John in 1 John chapter 4 will warn them about false teachers. I want you to be aware because there are going to be some false teachers in Ephesus, guys. And so Paul warns them about it. That's in Acts 20. It's when he's warning the elders that he's called from Ephesus to meet him in Miletus, and he says they're going to face these false teachers. And they'll be around, by the way, when Paul writes 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy. They're around already, and they're now around again. He's warned against them. The church in Ephesus had taken those warnings to heart, and so he says, you folks, put them to the test. You said, is this Bible or is it not Bible? If it's not Bible, we're not going to pay any attention to you. And so that becomes important for us. But I have this against you, he says, that you have left your first love. And I think that's the one verse that all of us have probably heard quoted more than any other out of this letter. You've left your first love. Therefore, remember from where you have fallen, repent and do the deeds you did at first, or else I am coming and I will remove your lampstand out of its place unless you repent. Interesting language. Now, this is the rebuke part, right? You can see it here. Despite their deeds and toil and perseverance, they have abandoned their first love. Now, it looks like they've hung in there, but their first love, that they don't have the zeal they once had, perhaps. Yes?
Basically what I was going to ask, what is their motivation for all the good they were doing if it wasn't for the love of Christ?
Yeah, that's a good question. My suspicion is that they don't have the zeal that they once had. They may still be doing some of the right things, but they may just be doing it because it's the thing to do. I think we sometimes do that as churches, don't we?
We just do the right stuff because it's the right thing to do, but we may have lost our zeal, our passion.
My next point was, for us,
yeah,
we can walk through the motions,
right,
and enjoy the blessings that comes from living the lifestyle that Christ wants, but we've missed the point.
Yeah.
We don't do it out of love.
Yeah, we don't do it out of love. Yeah. Yes.
Mike, is Ephesus here leaving their first love? The letter to Ephesus was like 58 to 60.
Uh-huh.
Remember? If you take the early time, 68, they didn't have time for all this to happen, which makes so much more sense for it to be 90.
Yeah, that's right.
It makes sense for this to be AD 90 to 95 in the 90s. During the time of Domitian, it makes good sense. This wouldn't be during the time of Nero. You know, we talked about that when we were talking about the futurists, some of the futurists who want to date it during the time of Nero. That doesn't, you're right. They've had time to do all of these good things and to build up a good reputation, but they've lost their first love. And I think that's interesting. They had cooled in their ardor of faith. That's how I described it. It would seem that almost contradicts the earlier praise. But I don't think it does. I think it's, they may be doing it, but they've lost the ardor that they had. Their love for one another, their spirit of Christian brotherhood had cooled down, and they maybe aren't showing the kind of love they ought to show for brothers and sisters. And that becomes a big deal for churches. If we're not showing that kind of love we ought to have for one another, there's no way we're going to reach out and share the good news with anybody else if they don't see us sharing it with one another. They had allowed fault-finding to stifle the true spirit of love, as one author put it. I like that. When the love of the brethren cools, love for God can't flourish. You can't love God much if you're not going to love your brothers and sisters. And you know, you may remember that John, when he writes 1 John, makes a big deal of that. And it's interesting to me that he almost has this circle. How do I know whether you love God if you love your brother? How do you know whether you love your brother if you love God? Where does it end? It doesn't end. The two go hand in hand. And since it's John who's writing this, and they've already read his book, I think, you know, that would make sense to them. They would understand that. The appeal for Christ of Christ involves three things. Number one, they are to remember where they once were. Remember the text. Remember where you have fallen. Remember where you once were and the kind of zeal you one time had. When you first became Christians, remember how that was? And so now he calls them to remember it. And so that's the first one. The second thing he calls them to do is to repent, to change their will, to change their direction. You're heading the wrong way, to do God's will. Repent. And he makes a big deal of repent. In fact, he'll say repent at least twice in our text. And then they are to act or do certain things. It's the fruits of repentance, and it will be the works you did at first. Remember how this church used to be, what it used to be like, how it used to do these wonderful, noble deeds, take care of brothers and sisters who were in need, reach out, be the kind of people they were. And it's a call for them to remember it and to go back and do the things they used to do. I don't want you to forget them. He says to start with, remember them, repent, and then do them. And then he calls them to repent. The threat is, unless they repent, He will come quickly and remove their lampstand. Your light's going to go out. Now, it's interesting that there's no church in Ephesus today. No, really, there are almost no quote-unquote churches at all. It's basically that whole area has gone Islamic. And so they've really lost their lamps. Their lampstand indeed is gone, which is really a shame. Yet this you do have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Okay, who in the world are Nicolaitans? We don't know much about them. You're exactly right. They hated the works of the Nicolaitans, and he said, that's good because I hate them too. Who the Nicolaitans were is the question. That's the debate. They're mentioned again in verse 15 when we get the letter to the church in Pergamum. They're also dealing with Nicolaitans, so we'll meet them there again. They're closely identified with holding the teaching of Balaam. And you may remember that the teaching of Balaam is brought up in 2 Peter and in Jude as well. Now, you got to remember good old Balaam. Let me see if I can bring up my slide. Here's good old Balaam. Balaam is the guy who has the talking donkey. Everybody remembers the talking donkey, right? Balak comes to him and says, I want you to curse the people of God. Curse these Israelites. He says, can't do that. God won't let me. And he says, I'll give you more money. And he goes to God and says, can I do it? And God says, no. And so then he's off on his way, heading to Balak again. And in fact, it's interesting because in Peter says he loved the wages of unrighteousness. He really wanted money. Money was more important to him than doing the will of God. And so he'll be going. And when he gets there, he says, no, I can't curse him. But I'll tell you what, I know exactly how you can do it. What you need to do is bring in these prostitutes, these women from these foreign women, and bring them in so they'll get involved in sexual immorality, and they'll eat food that has been sacrificed to idols, and they'll worship idols, and God will curse them. And you know what? God did. They did it, and they got cursed, and several folks will die from a plague. And so, in some ways, these guys are like good old Balaam. They seem to have held that it was lawful to eat things sacrificed to idols, to commit fornication, in opposition to the decree that was given to the churches in Acts 15. In Acts 15, you'll remember, here are the things that you Gentiles must do. And they've given in to those things. The teachers of the church branded them with this name that expressed their character. It's interesting because Irenaeus and Hippolytus and Clement of Alexandria will all mention them as being self-indulgent. And the one who's really interesting is Irenaeus. Irenaeus said that they were followers of Nicholas of Antioch, a proselyte who was among the seven men chosen to serve the church in Jerusalem. You remember, you've got the Greek-speaking widows who feel like they're being neglected, and they chose those seven men, and supposedly he says that this is one of those guys, because one of the guys was a guy named Nicholas, and that's how you'd get the name Nicolaitans. He had forsaken the true doctrine. They said that he lived in an unrestrained indulgence, and they follow him. Hippolytus agreed with this, noting that Nicholas left the correct doctrine and had a habit of indifference to what man ate and as to how he lived. And so that's the case. Apparently, they taught that it was all right for Christians to engage in the pagan heathen festivals and be a part of those. And again, that's going to be a real problem. Okay, now we come to the last part, and I'm just about where I'm supposed to be. It's amazing. Okay, here we go. He who has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. As I said earlier, that sounds just like Jesus. He'll give a parable and he'll say, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. If you got the right kind of heart, you'll hear the parables and you'll get the message. He's here saying, I want you to hear, and hear means obey. He who has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says. And hearing means more than just hearing it. You know, you heard the noise, heard the sound. It is to hear and obey. Interestingly enough, in Hebrew, they don't make a distinction. If you hear, you'll obey. And so they have the same word that they'll be used both ways, which I think is interesting. To him who overcomes, I will grant to eat the tree of life, which is in paradise, in the paradise of God. Okay, tree of life. What do you know about the tree of life? In the garden. That's exactly right. It was in the garden. That was the tree that they could eat from. They weren't supposed to eat from that forbidden tree. They do. And God's going to take them out of the garden where they can't eat from it anymore. And interestingly enough, in heaven, there's going to be a tree of life again. It's interesting because several of the things we're going to see in this book will be a rehearsal of Old Testament stories. This is one of those, remember I told you there were all of those 300 or 285 different places there's a reference to an Old Testament story. This is one. And so up in heaven, see the paradise of God. Paradise is another word. By the way, the word Eden means paradise. And so the paradise of God is heaven itself. And we'll eat from the tree of life, which means we're not going to die anymore. There won't be any more death. There'll be no more parting. We sing those kind of songs, don't we? No more parting, no more tears. All of that's gone. And so it's this wonderful picture, I think, of what's going to happen. The specific message for each church and to the other churches, they're all supposed to heed what's said here. It's not just for this church. He wants everybody to hear that. Okay, I did it with 2 minutes to spare. Okay, comments or questions, anybody?
The tree that's going to be in heaven is going to have all manner of fruit on it.
Yeah, that's right. Later on he'll say that this
tree is one that is ever-bearing, and it has all kinds of fruit. It's going to have apples and oranges and everything that we like. But it's the ideal tree. Yeah, good point.
The comment about the 7 being the perfect number, I remember hearing one time the fellow said that his thought might be God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, true love and knowledge, and they are revealed to mankind in all directions, for north, south, east, and west.
So you get the idea
that they reveal
God the Father, and then you get the north, south, east, and west of the whole world. North, south, east, and west.
And you remember I told you when you see that number 4, it often is used of the earth, where people are, the habitat for us. And so there may be even some sense to that, although I really think the number 7 is just a number that's, you know, that's a good number. If you want several, how many are several? Several's 7. At least we say that. Yes?
Realizing that man hasn't changed all that much, what do we have in today's society that compares with pagan religions of first century?
I think it is a matter of our doing what we want to do, whether God said do it or not. I mean, that basically, pagan religion then was, if it
makes you happy, you do it. I mean, there's a lot of that. And it really, pagan religion as a whole didn't have a lot to do with morals. And we live in a culture where morals don't make a big difference, unfortunately. She's shaking her head, yes. That's sort of where the kind of world we're living in now, where at least some folks don't see morals as really that important. And so I think that may be part of it, at least. All right, let's close with a prayer. Dear Lord, again, we thank you for the ways that you've blessed us, and we're grateful for your word, and we thank you for this lesson from the church at Ephesus. We pray, Lord, you'd help us to be good followers of the good they did, and help us not to lose that first love that we have for you as well. We ask your special blessings upon Bruce Goodnow and on Eric Naltz and on Kim Shaleen as she faces that surgery. We pray all would go well with her, keep her safe, and bring her out of that surgery with removal of all that cancer. We pray it would all go away. We ask your blessings upon the Andersons as they travel to be with us. We pray you'd give them safe travel as they come, and we pray that you'd be with us, Lord, as we strive to be your people. Help us to share the good news of Jesus with those around us, to be the kind of church you'd have us to be that shining light that we're called to be. And again, we thank you, Lord, for the blessings that we enjoy. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.